Okay, so little background on me. I started out as an engineer and then got into entrepreneurship. I've had the good fortune to be one of the top executives or founder of six successful startup companies, seven including Manhattan Street Capital. The six I've mentioned prior, we got positive liquid outcomes where everyone made money, the investors and the principals, the founders, and so forth. Two of those were IPOs to the NASDAQ. The first was Ashton Tate, which definitely frames my age, as you guys who remember Ashton Tate will know. We took co that company to the NASDAQ with great success. And the second is Symantec, where I was at Ashton Tate, I was vice president of sales when we went public. At Symantec, I was executive vice president and general manager of the Peter Norton Group. Actually, the acquisition of Norton was after the IPO. I was general manager of the biggest division of the company when we went public at Symantec, and then I was there about 10 years. I have also formed a venture capital firm in my past, which gives me relevant experience and expertise to bring to this table to the table here. Manhattan Street Capital, I launched the company with a co-founder in April of 2015 because of Reg A Plus. We were the first dedicated Reg A Plus funding platform. We are not a broker-dealer. We don't believe the long-run success model is to charge broker-dealer fees. We think they're too high. Over time, the cost of raising capital will reduce, is my expectation. We are not a broker-dealer. We exist under the exemptions which allow issuers to raise money via Reg A Plus or Reg D 506C, typically, where the issuers are allowed to do things like raise money, and we assist them in doing so. We're not a marketing agency. We are a funding platform, an advisory project management company. We bring in all the different players that are needed and jointly manage them where relevant in order to maximize the successful outcome of offerings that we assist with. You can see the type of offerings by looking at the Manhattan Street Capital website that we've already done. Okay, mentioned how to send questions. That is, reply to any of the emails you sent, you received inviting you to this event. That's rodturner@manhattanstreetinfo.com. Reg A Plus, what is Reg A Plus? It went live in late June of 2015. Reg A Plus allows companies to raise up to $50 million, 50 per year, from investors of any wealth level in most countries around the world, depending on the local regulations, of course. Most money does come in through US investors, also, of course. Investors don't have to be wealthy. Investors of any wealth level are allowed to invest. And as far as the SEC is concerned, those investors are liquid from the point in time that they receive their securities. So Reg A Plus can be used to conduct an IPO. It can be used for secondary offerings to replace an S3, or for secondary offerings for OTC companies. And the extension to reporting public companies was made in late December of 2018, which is kind of the genesis of this call, right? So Reg A Plus metrics, we track the metrics very closely. Our latest numbers go through the end of 2018. We'll be updating those for mid-year 2019 in the coming month or two. There's a lot of work involved. $1.6 billion raised through Reg A Plus in total through the end of 2018. Excuse me. The majority of that through tier two offerings, of course. And if you choose to, you can take a look at the blog and the news posts on the Manhattan Street Capital site, where we report and analyze on those metrics in great detail or in reasonably high detail. So, what are the advantages of Reg A Plus? Let's check the timing here. Reg A Plus over an S3. Primary advantages are that in the event you have an S3 on the shelf, that's a 3-year duration, that creates a 3-year period of time where investors may be worried that there's going to be a large block of shares sold. So there's some down pressure on the share price. The bigger issues, though, are the cost of doing an S3 is very high, and the complexity of work involved in getting it qualified or accepted, registered through the SEC is higher and more difficult than with a Reg A Plus. Reggae Plus is when it's appropriate for a company, Reggae Plus can be a very cost-effective method of raising capital. The most extreme example of that I'm personally aware of is a company, blanking on their name for a second, I'll probably get that in a minute, that raised $10 million in about 12 days live online, had a 5-day window, and then they shut down for a week or 10 days to figure out a problem they had with some of the states, and then they reopened. 12 days total online. VidAngel is the company name. They raised $10 million in that 12 days with no outreach marketing spend, with no broker-dealer assistance. Almost all of that from their customers. All they did to promote their offering, apart from spend a lot of money on a very nice video and offering page, was to email the 30,000 most active customers who were enthused about the company already at that point. That's the least expensive. They didn't give me the precise number, but you know when it's only been promoted by the sending of two emails to your own customers that this was not an expensive journey. That's the most extreme case. We have another example of a biotech company raising money where when you filter out the less effective marketing steps that they took and just focus on what worked, their outreach media spend, pure media spend, was about $3.50 for every $100 that they raised in Reggae Plus, which is probably at the very highest end of efficiency that one can aspire to in Reggae Plus. Of course, emailing your customers and fan base and having them invest is almost free. That's the best. But in terms of outreach to the great unwashed masses, communicating to them about your company, that's really inexpensive compared to an S3 method. When it works, it can be very effective. Compared to using Reg D for an OTC company, because we can reach out to consumer investors of any wealth level, you may be, in the case of a company that is appealing to Main Street investors, it can be very cost effective to raise money. Obviously not for a B2B company that is selling solutions to trash truck routing system software, right? You know, providing that kind of a solution, it's hard to get consumer level Main Street investors really enthused about that on its own, unless the security that's being offered is really motivating. Moving on now to, I've already touched a little on, does it suit your company? Is Reggae Plus a suitable instrument for your company? Over the years since I launched Manhattan Street Capital, that's been the biggest issue where I've had to say to companies in many cases, no, I don't think you should use Reggae Plus. In the case where you have a product or service that is hard to explain online through digital media, through social media advertising, that's going to be a tough one. If it's something that people don't care about, like the trash truck example I gave just now, that's going to be a tough one. You know, and if you have a compelling security, you know, if you're paying a high enough interest rate on a simple debt instrument, that can be very appealing in today's market. And if it's a stellar company doing something that's really really generates huge enthusiasm among investors, it doesn't have to be a B2B business. It doesn't have to be a B2C business. It helps if it is. But there are some B2B examples that can resonate. And again, if the security is attractive enough, if the company is solid enough, and the security is paying enough interest and is stable and looks to be stable on an ongoing basis, then that can change the equation. An advantage of Reggae Plus to bear in mind in all these instances is that because you are marketing to a broad swath of the population, if you're able to build increased demand by that marketing, then you get a double benefit, right? You know, every dollar you spend in outreach to bring in investors can bring in customers and people who become advocates and promote your brand, promote your company, increase sales, of course. And you know, there are cases where companies could raise the money a little faster, but would rather spread it out over the whole year in order to generate more customer traction in that manner. So now I'll move on to the top level view of the schedule in Reggae Plus. For already reporting public companies, obviously you already have audits in place, so that's a hurdle we don't have to deal with. And you already have practice at communicating with the SEC and writing documents that fit with SEC requirements, so that's an easier hurdle. So, you know, a month of preparation for the SEC Form 1A filing for the Reg A Plus is doable, more likely in this situation with this audience than in a company that hasn't heard of this sort of thing before. So 4 weeks would be, you know, that would be the best example, I would say, to get it prepared to file and then file it with the SEC, and 2 to 3 months to become qualified is reasonable to expect. So in this instance, we're talking a 3 or 4 month cycle to qualification. Of course, you know, big holidays like Christmas, government shutdowns like last year in January, this year, earlier than January this year, slow things down. But in the main, that's a reasonable expectation to have going in for this audience. Of course, you can make it more difficult. That's where we come in to help you figure out how to make it more straightforward, and where we can bring, if needed, securities attorneys to the table that know their stuff and know what the SEC wants to see and know what will more likely have a smooth journey through the SEC process. So once you're qualified, then you have 12 months with which to raise money. During that time, you are allowed to raise or lower the share price of your, or the price of your security within 20% cumulative change. It's very easy to do that. Once you exceed 20%, there's a new filing to the SEC, which may be a 2 or 3 week turnaround if you don't complicate it with lots of other variables. But not everyone is aware that you can do that in a Reg A Plus. So let me see, schedule. Yes, so you have 12 months to raise the money. You are allowed to prepare the next one before the end of the first one if you want to do back-to-back years. On an ongoing basis, you're allowed to do that. Okay, so now I'll move on to cost. I'm going to limit myself to companies that should do Reg A Plus, right? You know, it's kind of silly talking about companies that are preordained to not work in a Reg A Plus context. For companies for which this instrument is suitable, then, you know, I think assuming a raise of over 8 million, where the percentages start to make sense, a total cost of 10 to 12% of capital raised is a reasonable estimate. Of course, you can spend more than that. It can be done to bring it down lower. We have that biotech company I mentioned, their total cost, I think the last time I heard from them, was about 6.5%, an offering on Manhattan Street Capital with a remarkably low cost of marketing. And a really sweetheart deal from us that we don't offer anymore because they were earlier on in our lives when they signed up. But nevertheless, I think 6.5% was the cost they gave me. That's a pretty good deal, plus some warrants, but not a huge amount of them. But think 10 or 12%. Of course, if you bring in an underwriter and they add real value, they'll add real value and you need to spend less on marketing, but the fees will go much, much higher. But you know, the success model generally in Reg A Plus doesn't require that, and you can save a lot of money by doing the marketing through a dedicated marketing effort that is focused exclusively on raising money for your offering. So the upfront costs, securities law firm, you've got the audit already in hand, you've got the securities law firm is going to, assuming that the reporting of your company is current and that there aren't a bunch of errors that the SEC will find when they go look, then it could be lower than a regular standalone Reg A Plus. It could be 30 or 40K, as low as that, and much higher if there's a lot of mess to clean up, of course. And that isn't all payable immediately, but it's a liability you take on, one third up front, a third on filing, and a third on qualification. It's kind of typical for that. My recommendation in making a sizable Reg A Plus is that you set aside at least $300,000 or $400,000 as being enough to cover all the front-loaded expenses, in particular the marketing, because you don't want to be in a situation where the first stab at marketing stubbed its toe and the second one just starts to show its promise and you're running out of money because there wasn't enough money set aside. You know the way it is. If you need money, you can't raise it, right? You can only raise it when you're, you know, in a strong situation. So I would say at least 300K up front is smart. You're not going to need all of that up front, but having that amount of money available, particularly for the marketing spend, is appropriate to have in your thinking. Our fees are straightforward. We charge 10K a month, consulting and advisory project management, really, and 5K a month listing fee and warrants on both of those. And then for each investor who invests, we charge an admin and technology fee of $25 and $25 worth of warrants. Those are our fees in total. Those do not add up to a large amount of money typically. And that last one, the $25 fee, is not success-based. If somebody invests and they want their money back later, we still have to be paid that. If you had a minimum of, I wouldn't want you to do it, but if you had a minimum of $10 million for some reason and you only ever raised $6 million and then refunded everybody, we would still be, you would still have to pay us our $25 fees on that money, because we are not a broker dealer. We're not allowed to charge a success fee. That's really the only downside for you as an issuer with our fee structure, but we haven't had any significant issues where that's occurred. Schedule cost. Okay, broker dealer. This is a big one, because we work with, it's been a challenge to find broker dealers that will do Reg A pluses at modest fees. It isn't required to have a broker dealer on a Reg A plus offering, but there are 7 states that don't cooperate with the SEC. We have information in the FAQ on the Manhattan Street Capital site. If you choose to search for it, look at the search icon in the top right-hand corner of the site, and you'll see it. The 7 problem states are not playing ball with the SEC, and they are requiring companies to file for blue sky exemptions with them anyway. Actually, not particularly, it is for blue sky exemptions, but also in many cases to be a broker dealer of record in that state, you know, vary state by state. It's cumbersome, it's slow, it's a pain in the neck. You can do it for the main states, which are Texas and Florida, where the biggest group of investors are. But it is easier to use a broker dealer for that. And we can get you a 1% fee via a broker dealer for that service. So that's a heck of a lot of savings over paying 7 or 8% to an underwriter, which is what would be the case that you would normally pay, of course. And very reasonable money when an underwriter is underwriting and raising the money for your company, you know, more power to them. That's a very worthwhile thing. So the advantage then, the reason why to have a broker dealer for this purpose is to enable the company to raise money from residents of the 7 problem states. In fact, Florida has made it more difficult recently, where apparently now if a company is an issuer based in Florida, they won't allow you to raise money from investors anywhere in the US without either a national a broker dealer at the national level or at the Florida state level, or being registered with Florida to be your own broker dealer with the state of Florida. So that's a big one, you know. That's a significant restriction, especially because their staff are, the department is understaffed and they have a hiring freeze, I'm led to believe. So bear that in mind, Florida. A lot of investors in Florida. Okay, now moving on to marketing. I touched on that earlier. You can't consider marketing in isolation. Marketing has to be integrated into the platform with which you are raising money. It has to be easy for the investor. Of course, I'm biased, right? A large part of what we do is make it easy for investors to invest via debit card, via ACH, check, and wire transfer. A debit card is huge for the younger generation, you know, the millennials in particular. And it is, if you have a debit card, it is the easiest way to invest quickly and get it done. So you've got things like that. It has to be well organized. It has to be a nice, easy user interface. We do those things. We put a lot of emphasis on that. Of course, here I am plugging away at how great we are. Pardon me for that. But it also matters to intelligently integrate the website tracking of the marketing influx from your advertising. So social media advertising is the primary source of cost-effective outreach to new investors. Email is a dog generally, and I could get into more detail on that, but that's okay. We bring in a marketing agency or more than one till we find a great fit. The marketing agency works for you and we help you direct them to do an excellent job. When they bring in potential investors, that we need to know, we need to tie, and we do tie, the information from which ad, which campaign, which target audience, on what occasion, brought in that potential investor. And then we track them to see what they do. If they do nothing much, then we know we're not too excited about that ad campaign, right? If we get a lot of investors putting in a larger amount of money, we go back and we see which ads, which campaigns, which target audiences tied into that. And we crank up the spend there and turn down the spend on the ineffective ones. Having that integration is essential. And you know, you guys probably are fully aware of this, but when you're working with Google AdWords, which isn't as effective as social media, but when you're using any of these online instruments to raise money, they can only, to the extent you're using optimization algorithms and methodology, particularly in Facebook and Instagram, they can only optimize against something which lots of people do, which happens on the occasion when the potential investor arrives on your site or on the offering platform. So what are you going to do? I mean, you can't expect them to invest. The number of people who invest immediately upon arrival, first visit, is very slim, of course. Some people do it, but it is slim. To get the numbers up to where optimization can work, it's got to be something easier. So we grab the email from people before we allow them to see the investment process, and we get a very high penetration rate there. And that email, gathering of that email, then the advertising software algorithms are optimizing to that, which can be entirely useless if tire kickers who can't afford to invest are giving us their email, which is where the back end bit comes in, right? Got to integrate those together. Okay, so outreach marketing, it's got to be very direct, it's got to be straightforward. You have to leverage the fact, it has to be the case that your offering is compelling and attractive and can be explained quickly in a few words, right? And by imagery. Not every company can be explained in that way. So that's a big piece of the puzzle when it comes to making this work. Okay, now I'll move on to, actually, on marketing, you should expect, not initially, you should expect more inefficient marketing at the beginning, when all the beginning, where all the tuning is being done, optimizing the various things I just touched on. So the front end, the front loaded spend is going to be more expensive, more inefficient. But as you build an audience, build a following, build an email list with which to follow up with people that are engaged and interested and contemplating investing in your company, then the efficiency can increase significantly as we go forward. And so there are certainly marketing agencies that think, that expect that you should spend at least 10% of capital raised just on marketing. I don't subscribe to that program. I believe it can be and should be doable at a far lower price. I think goaling it down as low as possible is what we have to do. And 3%, 4%, 5%, 6% is where I'd like to see it. And we've had success with that. Certainly, you know, it isn't always going to be that low, but that's what we strive for. Okay, now I'm going to move on to the size of the raise. The SEC, if you are buying an asset, buying a building, buying a company, then let's say the price is $8 million, then you need to have an escrow of $8 million, and you can't close escrow until you exceed that number to buy the asset, because obviously raising $6 million isn't going to cut it. But if in the event that your raise is geared to growing your business and raising $1 million or $500,000 or $200,000 is materially valuable to you, then you are allowed to do essentially a zero minimum raise by Reg A Plus, where you can do closes from the beginning every time there's significant money in escrow, do the once a week, that kind of thing. The cost involved is minimal to do that, and then issue the shares on the investors that you've closed. So that's important to know. Not everyone's aware of it. And then the other thing to be cognizant of is that while Reg A Plus has a maximum raise amount of $50 million, it's generally a good idea to, if you need to raise, say, $14 million, it's a good idea to set a higher maximum, maybe as high as $50 million, but certainly higher than the planned raise, because of two things. You might get lucky where the efficiency of the raising is going very, very well. It may be a good opportunity to accelerate the growth of the business in a way you hadn't anticipated, where raising more money is very synergistic suddenly, or very very resonant with the business. And you are allowed to raise the share price as you go. So you might pause the offering after 5 months, raise the share price significantly, and raise a lot more money because you may have room for yourself when you file the Reg A Plus in the first place. So I would recommend you consider that. Okay, now I'm going on to my last agenda item, which is mistakes to avoid, and then we'll move on to Q&A. So some of these mistakes may be a tad obvious based on what I said before. Okay, so mistakes to avoid. Not having having a company where you shouldn't really be doing a Reg A Plus, for example, there's no consumer appeal or it's really difficult to explain to consumers. That's obviously a very big mistake to avoid. If the deal is confusing, if the security is confusing, if it's a limited partnership entity or an LLC, that will cause a tripping hazard. It's easier to sell shares to people or bonds or, a security that people can understand. Having a complicated offering with various complexities involved in it is not a good thing. We need to keep it simple. So what we want to avoid, if you think about it, is if once we've got somebody seriously enough interested that they're going to spend time to go through the offering, then we need to avoid confusing them with too many dilemmas, too many questions, too much confusion. If they get confused about it and say to themselves, you know what, this is really interesting, I'll come back and look at this later, you're probably going to lose 50, 60, 70% of those folks. Okay, going back to the items I mentioned, there's going back to the broker-dealer thing, there are essentially three levels in which broker-dealers get involved with Reg A Plus. One is as an underwriter, already touched on it. Another is as a value-added involved entity bringing investors in. Very rarely does that work. And it only works when the offering has already shown tremendous success online. The broker-dealer staff, their sales reps, don't want to take a risk with damaging their customer relationships until the offering is already successful. So it's generally not a very big success model to depend on the broker-dealer to do that. The third level of involvement is the one I mentioned earlier, where they're basically there to bless the offering, to do some due diligence work, and to enable you to easily raise money in the problem states. That's the one that works the best, and that's 1%. So it's a much more handleable cost. That's realistic. They will do that and they'll do it well. Then other mistakes, too low a maximum. I mentioned the rationale for having a higher maximum so you're not as limited. You can't go back to the SEC during your first year and raise the maximum. That's a new filing. That's why having a higher maximum at the get-go is better. Another mistake I see a lot of is setting too high a minimum investment amount per investor. The reason that matters so much is not so much because investors will always put in the minimum. That does happen sometimes. But the biggest issue is when you are reaching out to investors online with digital advertising, someone sees what looks like a potentially interesting company, they click to the offering page, and they want to know if they're allowed to invest. They want to know if they can afford to play invest in your company. Because at this point, it's pretty casual how interested they are. If your minimum is $3,000 or $4,000, $5,000, a lot of people at that point aren't willing to gamble that amount of money because they just saw the ad. They just clicked to the offering page. If the minimum is too high, they'll leave and never return. So you need a low enough offering, $200, $300, $400, $500 in that zone, so that people will stick around, continue to engage and look, maybe invest a nominal sum, maybe come back through their IRA and invest a larger sum later, maybe just invest more later. But typically, when you see offerings, when I monitor what's going on, when I monitor offerings that are successful in Reg A Plus, that have a low minimum, the amount invested is far higher on average than the minimum. So you may have a $200 or $300 minimum and an average investment amount of $2,000, $3,000, $4,000. One of our companies has an average of about $8,000 with a minimum of about $320, I think. So when the offering is compelling enough and you're appealing to the right audiences, they'll put in more money. But you want to make sure you keep them engaged and you don't lose them in the first few seconds after they initially arrived on your offer. A big, big issue for companies that are already trading that are penny stocks, whether they're on the NASDAQ or on an OTC market, this is a huge issue. We've discussed this, we've explored doing secondaries via Reg A Plus for many companies that are that have hammered share prices. And my observation of this, we're not a broker dealer, we're not underwriters, we are not allowed to structure transactions. I can observe what's working and I can advise you of what I see working, but I cannot say do this, do that, this is what you should do. That's an underwriter's job. But what I can say to you is that if your stock is hammered, doing an offering at a higher share price is probably going to fail, right, for the same security. If your share price is heavily depressed, selling shares at a sensible valuation that are going to be liquid on the same exchange that are going to experience the same dynamics is a recipe for disaster. So don't do that. You know, create a new security that is appealing and that will not convert into your common stock is what I would recommend. And I've had companies that have approached us that are doing Reg A pluses that are not yet live that are taking that path. And I think that's a very smart approach to take, because that way they can raise the money in order to accelerate the growth of their company. You can raise the money to accelerate the growth of your company. And if you raise enough money to give yourself enough runway to build credibility, to build momentum, to build profitability, then that will probably have a very beneficial effect on your common stock price. Perhaps if you have somebody out there shorting the stock, that turns them around, puts them at risk. Or if you have somebody with debt that's selling shares and hammering your share price, maybe you can buy them out with the proceeds from the offering. But you do need to make sure that the offering size has enough scale to it to deal with the issues you have to deal with, so that this isn't just a temporary placebo transaction. In today's environment, companies that are making offerings that are simple debt instruments are getting a great deal of interest, because it's such a low interest rate environment in a Reg A Plus context that is generating a lot of enthusiasm from investors. So I think, you know, bear that in mind. And I mentioned this earlier in another context, it's a very big mistake to think that you have because you have a compelling offering and good marketing, that then using some third-party investment software, or worse still, a broker dealer's investment software, where 9 times out of 10 they require every investor to open a brokerage account and answer the Spanish Inquisition type of question list, which takes an hour. Somebody thinking of investing $500 or $2,000 generally doesn't want to spend all that amount of time. That's why most of the Reg A Plus IPOs, except Arcimoto, which we hosted on Manhattan Street Capital, where they raised $4 million online in 4 weeks at the same time as the underwriter, Hambrecht, W.R. Hambrecht, raised $15.5 million through their broker-dealer efforts. All the other Reg A Pluses, to my knowledge, that were IPOs used broker-dealer platforms where the investors had to sign up to open another brokerage account and answer all those questions about all of their investment history and proclivities, preferences, and so forth. And when people are faced with that, they just don't do it. So do not shortcut the investment process. Clearly, I'm biased, right? You know, we have an offering platform, we make it really easy, but you know, even if you're not going to use my company and our platform, make sure you use a platform that is really well integrated into the marketing and makes it really easy and does things like accept debit cards for real, so that it's easy for investors. 40% of one of our offerings, capital raising of late, is coming through debit card. 40% of the capital through debit card. Yes, okay. Expanding on the variable share price or security price in a Reg A Plus. Within the first 12 months, that is one offering, you are allowed with a notification filing to the SEC to notify them that you are changing your share price up to a maximum of 20% shift So if you started at $10, the highest you could go in increasing it would be $12, right? That's the maximum that you could do with this notification method. You could do it in multiple steps. It doesn't have to be one step. When you have filed that notification with the SEC on EDGAR, you must, within 48 hours, switch to that new price. You may no longer, after 48 hours, no longer offer the old price. You can go up or down. Obviously, going down is less exciting. It creates a wait-and-see mentality for investors or from investors. If you choose to exceed a 20% cumulative shift in share price, then you do a filing with the SEC where you ask them for permission and you go quiet and you can't raise money during that time. I've been advised, and people have done that in 2 or 3 weeks with the SEC when that's the only thing you do. If you overload that request of the SEC with a bunch of overhead other things, then it could take longer, and it has done so. Let me see. Okay, this is asking about a secondary marketplace. So can Manhattan Street Capital or an issuer create a message board website for Reg A plus investors to buy and sell shares on a secondary marketplace? I don't know the answer to that question. I've been advised by somebody I like and respect that that's yes, but I have not done the due diligence. There are one or two aftermarket platforms that are trading Reg A plus shares. I think Folio, as a broker dealer, is doing so. They would be my first port of call. Folio Institutional, go to them. They're involved in some Reg A plus transactions, and they I haven't checked the viability, the liquidity of it, but they do trade. Another option that I've been approached by a number of European and Asian-based exchanges that were established to do crypto trading and have some of them have good liquidity, where they're happy to list Reg A plus shares post-offering. And you are allowed to list your shares on those exchanges offshore if you choose to. You are not allowed to promote to US investors that they should use those exchanges. You are allowed to tell all of your investors that you have listed your shares or securities on those exchanges. And the ones that have approached me are offering modest fees, modest cost to list, modest trading costs, and some of them have good liquidity. So that may be a useful solution. The other thing you can do in Reg A plus for liquidity purposes is, as you will see with Fundrise and other REITs that are using Reg A plus, Fundrise has raised, I think I said earlier, 1.6 billion is the total capital raised through the end of 2018. About 62% of that has been raised in real estate offerings. Fundrise is, as of the end of 2018, over 500 million of capital they've raised in Reg A pluses along the way. They offer limited direct liquidity to the investor. That is something which you can do as long as it's structured into the offering. You can build that into your plan where you are directly exchanging securities with the investors on a limited basis. You're not allowed to do it in a gay free-for-all, which could cause a run on the bank. The SEC won't allow that. The SEC is very concerned with a thing called Regulation M, for mother M. They restrict these practices because they want to avoid abusing the practice, right? But it is legitimate to offer direct liquidity from the issuer to investors in a Reg A plus context. I can give you more detail on some really interesting upsides in that are not generally known. But the point is, yes, you can do that on a limited basis. With Fundrise, they provide this liquidity method, and it is of limited utility, but it does increase the appeal of their offerings, that they offer some liquidity. That's a good thing. They charge fees, they charge penalties for people who redeem early. That reduces the appeal to the investor, but it does reduce the likelihood of, casually, people investing casually and redeeming casually. Okay, so the question here is, can I go over test the waters? And I'll explain that. There's a couple more questions here. So test the waters is actually a program that I suggested to the SEC in the summer of 2012 when they had an open forum. And I believe that was my suggestion that caused them to do it. I don't have proof, but I suggested this specifically by another name, which was something we were already doing on an earlier company. Anyway, so Test the Waters allows any company that chooses to use Tier 2 Reg A Plus as a vehicle without filing with the SEC, you can promote an offering online, which isn't actually an investment offering. It's a would you like this offering, right? You can't accept investments, obviously, because this is not filed with the SEC. If you look on our platform, we have towards the homepage, towards the bottom of the homepage, you'll see a couple of companies that use our service called Crowd Audition, where we help companies in a turnkey manner test the waters, put together the listing and the offering marketing in order to test out what they want to do and see how appealing it is to investors. You're allowed to do that as long as the SEC obviously cares greatly that nobody starts actually raising money in a non-registered, non-qualified offering. But you're allowed to market it. You're allowed to do emails to promote it as long as you are overt about what you're doing and you use the proper SEC disclaimer, which you will see on our website on the reservation offerings. A company that's already public can do it, yes. A company that's private can do it, yes. You are not required, if you do a test the waters, you're not required to then do a Reg A Plus. It's testing the waters to see if you like it. You could go ahead and say, yeah, you know, I'm not going to do this. I'll do an IPO, or I'm going to do a Reg D. Why would I bother? This isn't different enough for me. It's a test the waters. It's literally a market test. So in terms of who can do a Reg A Plus, it has to be a US or Canadian headquartered company. It can be a non-US entity that establishes US presence. It has to be a legitimate presence. It can't be, oh, everyone lives elsewhere and they check in once in a while. It has to be a real US entity or Canadian entity. It can already be public. If it's a non-reporting or a reporting public company, you are allowed to use Reg A Plus. That the addition of the ability to for reporting companies to use Reg A Plus was made on December 18th of 2018. That was a significant extension of Reg A Plus to enable existing public companies to conduct Reg A Pluses without having to use a new subsidiary or something. You can do it from the main entity. And then the company must be legitimate. It needs to be a C Corp or an LLC or a limited partnership. It must be in good standing, et cetera, right? Those things go without saying. Liquidity, you can list the shares on the OTCQB or QX. Once you have completed your Tier 2 Reg A Plus, then the cost, I believe the cost is it may have gone up from 2,500 to 5,000. I think it's now 5,000 to list on the QB. And any tier, theoretically, they've said this to me, any Tier 2 Reg A Plus that completes is qualified enough to list on the OTCQB. And if you do so, then your reporting obligation on the QB is the same as in Reg A Plus. So a non-public company, not already doing PCAOB audits, not already public, can do a Reg A Plus, and then the SEC required reporting post-transaction is once a year US GAAP audit, which is relatively non-onerous, once every 6 months management financials unaudited, and any material event must be reported when it occurs within a few days. So that's a pretty lightweight burden for a non-public company to live with, and that continues on the OTCQB unchanged. For companies that list on the QX, OTCQX requires quarterly management financials and still only an annual US GAAP audit. So the QX is a little more demanding, but both of those are such a lightweight burden compared to a company that was, you know, that is a shell or was a shell, you know, that still has the PCAOB reporting obligation for quarterly audits. So I mentioned you can list on the OTC markets. You cannot list. You can list elsewhere around the world. And you can list if you satisfy the NASDAQ, which means a two-year history and you raise enough money and otherwise satisfy them that you are a real business, you can list on the NASDAQ as well. But to understand how the SEC, I'm putting myself in there issues, which is kind of silly, but the SEC doesn't really care very much about if you want to list on the London Stock Exchange and you satisfy their standards, cool, more power to you. That doesn't gain you or cost you standing with the SEC. It's different. That's what you're doing in the UK, and the same thing goes for the Canadian exchanges. Cannabis stocks, blind pools and funds. So cannabis stocks, we're basically nervous about cannabis stocks, THC. So we're limiting ourselves as to which cannabis companies we'll take on. If they don't touch anything to do with THC, then it's good. In the event that it's THC related, then we will do offerings for companies, but only to states where what they do is legal. Only to US states where what they do is legal, to avoid repercussions for us as a platform. Funds, you'll see a lot of the REITs, a lot of real estate funds raising money via Reg A+. Real estate has special exemptions which give you more flexibility. It's possible in very specialized circumstances to do a venture lending fund via Reg A+. You should reach out to me on that, because I understand it relatively well, I think quite well. But in real estate, it's a lot easier to do a lending fund that lends money for real estate purposes. That's the best case example. Blind pools, you can't do a SPAC with Reg A+. You can't do a blind pool, to my knowledge. There may be some specialized exemption that I'm not aware of. But a legitimate company that is based in the US or Canada and has real people in it and has a clean record is allowed to do a Reg A+. That doesn't mean it's a smart idea, right? I gave you that other criteria earlier, but allowed to, yes. Another good thing to know is you are allowed by the SEC to conduct a Reg D offering at the same time as a Reg A+. That's something useful to know. Obviously, the terms can be different. You can be selling a preferred share class at a different share price with different terms to Reg D investors while simultaneously raising money in a Reg A+. Yeah, a non-US company, we've dealt with a number of companies outside the US that have sufficient scale and success and confidence that they want to list in the US or at least do a Reg A+ in the US. And we'll help with that for the right companies. We're happy to help with that. But they must establish a US entity to use Reg A+, not Reg D. Reg D, you can be a non-US entity, and you can use Reg S to raise money from non-US investors as well. But Reg A+ does require a genuine entity with real board members that are US resident and executives that are US resident and similar. And we can advise further on that. So coming to raise the money, I would suggest any of you guys who are considering using Reg A+ or Reg D, check with us, look through the FAQs, look at the blog posts. We have a huge amount of expertise on the offering on our website to help you guys figure out whether to do this. And if it looks to you like we're saying you should, based on reading the documentation we have, then send us an email. And we'll be happy to advise you via email or have a phone call if it makes sense, right? That's what we do. On a constant, ongoing basis, we receive inquiries from companies wanting to know if they should do Reg D, Reg S, and especially Reg A+, which is kind of the nicest model because it can work so beautifully well in the right cases. Question here is about a B2B model where an equipment finance or lease company creates a specific niche solution. Yeah, but that's a very specialized question. The truth is that a B2B company, this is talking about an equipment supplier financing, it's going to be difficult to do a B2B company just from the get-go. Because if you think about it from this point of view, Reg A+ comes into its own when we're appealing to Main Street investors. Okay, they have high disposable income. They may be accredited. They may be wealthy without being accredited. They are more optimistic and more open-minded about investing in companies that they like. Reg D investors, if you want to appeal to them, it's much more difficult because guess what? Accredited investors have a bazillion places they can put their money, don't they? They have a lot more options before them as to where they can invest. So if we take what would suit a Reg D, which is, hey, a real business, real profits and real growth, but awfully difficult to explain by online advertising, that might work in an IPO. It might work in a Reg D scenario, depending. but it probably will not work in a Reg A plus because we cannot easily communicate it succinctly to Main Street investors. When we resonate with Main Street investors is when the costs go down, when the marketing works and hits its stride beautifully, that's what makes Reg A plus a thing of joy. DTC eligibility. So when you list your company then on an exchange, then DTC eligibility is a process. It costs $16,000 or so, maybe a bit less, maybe a bit more, to make it easier for your shares to be transferred into the brokerage account of the investor. So this works best in a NASDAQ type situation, but it can work on the OTC as well. It's a little bit less obvious sometimes there. Again, I hope this has been helpful. We're about helping you figure out if this is the right thing to do. We do not want to waste your time and money or our time and resources doing offerings that are preordained to fail, right? It's pretty obvious. That's a waste of time and money. So if you can contact us, you can be assured that we're not going to waste your time telling you how exciting it is to do something when we think it's a bad idea. That's a big piece of what we do. In the earlier years of this company, I was saying no to 18 or 19 out of 20 companies that we'd have meetings with. These days it's better because there's more osmosis, there's more knowledge on our platform, helping people understand if this is the right instrument to use or not. So it's important for you to know that you can have faith that we're legit people, because we are. I don't have to do this. I do this because I enjoy it and I think I'm good at it. And I enjoy adding value. And I think Reg A Plus is a marvelous instrument when used in the right place. Can you raise funds to build manufacturing in Italy for product sales in the USA and Europe? Probably yes. If you're really genuinely going to sell those products in Europe, then yes. You need to set a US entity up or Canadian headquarters for a US entity. It would raise the money in its own right. It wouldn't be raised by the Italian entity, but it can raise money here and deploy that money in Italy. The fact that it's actually planning to sell the products in the USA and Europe is legitimate. It will be a bit more difficult to raise money if a lot of the presence of the company is European based, right? You know, US investors can more easily buy into a company that is US centric, that is a US entity. So as long as it's a legitimate entity that is actually operating in the US with real people, then you can do that. Would B2B selling software for hospitals be a good candidate for Reg A Plus? The answer is it depends, but only if the existence of these hospitals would be appealing to Main Street investors, which could truly be, right? If it genuinely is. Good. We're going to wrap. Thank you very much, everybody. I hope this has been worthwhile. And look forward to talking to you in the future as necessary and as appropriate. Thanks again. Have a good day.